I'm Kate, and on this episode of Bite Size, we're exploring kombucha. Kombucha is a fermented tea, so basically take your basic sweet tea and add a sour note to it, as well as some fizziness, all due to the fermentation, and then you can also add in extra flavors, which you often see in commercial kombucha. We're going to explore all that and more. So I've definitely drank a lot of kombucha before, but I've never brewed it. I've been curious, but also a little intimidated. And luckily enough, for this episode, I was able to talk to someone who's brewed about 35 kombucha batches back in their college days and was a wealth of expertise.
My name is Molly Levins. I graduated in 2019 from Harvard College with a self-design major in food and the environment. I became interested in fermentation during college and have fermented just about everything you can try to ferment in your home kitchen.
So let's start off with the basics. What's the key to brewing your own kombucha? It's all about the microbes. They take what is just a basic brewed tea with some sugar and transform it to that fizzy, tangy kombucha. And the way they do that is through fermentation. So we originally designed this episode as a more advanced explanation and dive into fermentation after doing the basics in our kimchi episode. Also, it was a little self-serving. I've always wanted to brew kombucha, so was pretty excited about it too. But as we were doing the research and exploring this and talking to Molly, I realized that the more interesting piece here is that community of microbes and how they work together. So that's what we're going to focus on today. Specifically, it's all about how the bacteria and yeast work together. But first, let's just look at the beginning steps of making and brewing your own kombucha.
Day one, we brewed some tea. This can either be green or black tea, and added sugar to it. Then, once it had cooled down to room temperature, we added two things to speed up the fermentation process. A little bit of store-bought kombucha and a SCOBY. Then we covered it with a coffee filter and let it sit.
So I'm guessing everything looked pretty familiar, and then I added in a SCOBY, which looked pretty weird and kind of gross. So what is that thing?
SCOBY is actually an acronym for Symbiotic Culture of Bacteria and Yeast. The word symbiotic describes symbiosis, which is a long-term relationship between two species in which at least one benefits, and in mutualism, which is a type of symbiosis, both species benefit. And that's at the crux of this episode. The bacteria and yeast work together and help each other. And this special mutualistic symbiotic relationship between the two is actually quite complex, and they help each other out in a variety of ways. This weird jelly-like disc is made up of cellulose, which is produced by the bacteria living inside the kombucha, and it grows over time as the community of microorganisms thrive.
When you start with a SCOBY, the fermentation happens a lot faster than if you try to grow your own SCOBY.
So if you start a kombucha without a SCOBY, where do the bacteria and yeast originally come from?
Everywhere. There are yeast and bacteria living even in the air, so they will make their way into your sugar tea as soon as you leave it out. However, if you do not start with a SCOBY, I would recommend using a starter culture, and it will give the yeast and bacteria you want a head start over the yeast and bacteria that you do not want.
Over time, I realized that this weird thing was the most important component in the process of making kombucha. It was a key piece of evidence, and actually I think the most helpful piece, that fermentation was occurring, the bacteria and yeast were present, and they were living healthily in the kombucha.
I compare SCOBYs to coral reefs. So they are like the home to the community. And if you know anything about ecology, once you take away the coral reef, that's like the breeding ground for a lot of fish. It's kind of the center of this ecosystem. And so there are definitely organisms that are living outside. So the entire kombucha is filled with these microorganisms, but the home or the SCOBY is especially important to their survival.
So what do we do after day one? Well, it's actually pretty easy on our part. We don't need to do anything. We're just monitoring the fermentation process. And the two things we're going to look at is pH or acidity, as well as the SCOBY itself.
Why are these the most helpful indicators? We're actually going to flip the script and dig into the science first before we show our experimentation. So our microbial community in the kombucha consists of different yeast and bacteria. Now, there's a variety of different types of bacteria that have been reported in kombucha. Most belong to a family of bacteria called Acetobacteriaceae. Within this family, there's a wide variety of genera and species. One key characteristic of this type of bacteria is that they produce acetic acid, and this distinguishes them from another type of bacteria we often see in fermentation, lactic acid bacteria. Both types of bacteria produce an acid, which results in a lower pH and that acidic, tangy flavor, but there are different types of acids. Another key distinction is that lactic acid bacteria don't need oxygen, while acetic acid bacteria do. So in foods that have lactic acid fermentation, like our kimchi, we took steps to remove air from the jar, like tightly packing the cabbage and fully sealing it because the air has oxygen. However, acetic acid bacteria need oxygen, which is why we didn't fully seal the kombucha and just covered it with a coffee filter as it sat and fermented over the week. Okay, so this struck me as confusing to start with because I thought one of the key pieces to fermentation is that cells do it when they don't have access to oxygen, right? We have aerobic respiration, which is what they do when they do have access to oxygen, and then anaerobic respiration or fermentation is what they do when they don't have access to oxygen. So why are we saying that the acetic acid bacteria need oxygen here? Well, it's because the bacteria aren't the only microorganisms living in the kombucha. There's also yeast. And like the bacteria, there are a variety of different species of yeast.
And a lot we're still discovering in this space. So there's still ongoing research onto all these different varieties, and that your specific variety will probably depend on where you're living and what your starter culture is and other environmental conditions, such as like temperature of your kitchen.
The yeast are the ones that take the sugar we added to the kombucha and use it in fermentation. And if we want to be a little bit more specific, they actually produce enzymes that take the sugar, which is in the form of sucrose, and break it down to simpler sugars, glucose and fructose. And from here, they use the glucose to create ATP, their form of energy to survive and do all the jobs needed within the cell. Now, in the end, in addition to ATP or energy, carbon dioxide, water, and ethanol is produced. Ethanol is a type of alcohol. Now, here's where it gets interesting, and we see the first hints of the symbiotic relationship between yeast and bacteria. That ethanol produced by the yeast is then used by the acetic acid bacteria in cellular respiration. The bacteria oxidize the ethanol to create acetic acid. This occurs in the bacteria cell in between the cell wall and plasma membrane, thanks to several different enzymes. Now, a key part of this chemical reaction, as you can see here, is that oxygen is needed. The role acetic acid bacteria are playing is oxidation of the ethanol, the alcohol, produced by the yeast in fermentation. So let's just recap for a sec. We add sugar to our beginning kombucha. That sugar is used and fermented by the yeast to create ethanol, which is then used by the bacteria to create acetic acid, and that acid is what gives kombucha its tangy, acidic flavor. The bacteria and yeast are working together to survive, and basically we capitalize on this because it's what we want in our kombucha. However, there are other ways in which they're helping each other survive in this special symbiotic, mutualistic relationship. The first goes back to our SCOBY, which the bacteria are responsible for producing. SCOBY is really important and acts as a home for both the bacteria and the yeast. This also explains why the SCOBY floats the way it does and why we want a wide jar.
You will have a faster fermentation the wider the container. So the more there's that surface interface, the faster your fermentation will go. Your SCOBY will grow and fill whatever jar you give it.
The SCOBY also acts as a physical barrier, blocking both unwanted microbes, like ones that could result in mold, and the majority of oxygen from getting into the liquid so the yeast can undergo fermentation. Additionally, we mentioned earlier that the yeast produce an enzyme that helps break down the sugar in the form of sucrose that we've added into simpler forms of glucose and fructose. This helps both the yeast, but also the bacteria, who also need glucose to respire and live. One last thing, the bacteria produce acetic acid, which helps in flavor, but also creates an environment with a low pH, which makes it difficult for other competing microbes that we don't want in the kombucha to survive. So basically, the fermentation process will continue to happen until all of the sugar that we originally put in is converted into acid, which basically is vinegar. So the amount of time we allow for that process to happen is the key to the level of acidity.
Okay, so let's get back to our kombucha. Are all the things that we just talked about actually happening in the jar? And how do we know if it's happening? That was like my number one question. Is it working? Please tell me it's working.
They would send me photos of their SCOBY often and say, like, is this okay? Because 90% of the time, your SCOBY is going to look super nasty. I had a lot of fun in a lot of the early stages. I made some really bad kombuchas and some really good ones. And then I experimented with like how to reuse the SCOBYs. And it was kind of a playground in the kitchen. So much of it is kind of figuring it out. There is definitely this like problem solving of like, oh, when you see this happen, I have made enough at this point to know how to intervene.
So when is the kombucha done? Well, here's the cool thing that I realized after talking to Molly. It's up to you and how tangy and acidic you want the kombucha to be. As the kombucha sits and ferments, more acetic acid is being produced and the more acidic it gets. So it's up to you to decide when it's acidic enough and when you consider your kombucha to be done. If you think it's not acidic enough, you just let it continue to ferment. If it's too acidic, you can also dilute it or add some sugar to it to kind of tame it down a little bit. So what happens if you just leave it? Funnily enough, when I'm doing research, this is actually one of the most Googled questions. Like it popped up in the autofill, what do I do with my kombucha if I'm going on vacation?
I came back after a summer, the entire jar had turned into a SCOBY. So it had consumed everything in the jar and what little liquid was there was extreme vinegar. But I then put that SCOBY into sugary tea and that turned into kombucha.
The other big question I had for Molly was all about flavor. Most recipes say you can either use black or green tea, and to be honest, I spent way too much time debating on which one I should do.
For flavor, it largely depends on your preference for green versus black. The final product won't taste exactly like green tea or black tea in the same way that wine doesn't taste just like grape juice. Flavor compounds also get changed through the fermentation process. A green tea in general will be lighter in flavor. From my research, people generally find that their SCOBY is healthier when they use at least some green tea. Either that's a mix or entirely green tea. And if you look at the ingredients on most commercial kombuchas, green tea is one of the ingredients.
This immediately led to my second question. How do you get flavor? I mean, pretty much all the kombuchas I've ever seen at the store are flavored.
Recommendation is to add flavorings after your primary fermentation. Flavors change really dramatically through fermentation. And so if you add strawberries or something, you're like, oh, this is going to be so fruity, so strawberry flavor, it's going to taste really different if you allow those strawberries to ferment.
Now, this is assuming that everything is going exactly according to plan, which we know is not necessarily going to happen. Within a day or two, my SCOBY wasn't really floating. It hadn't totally sunk, but I was a little concerned. And then later, it also was growing a little bit of white mold, which even had me more concerned. We ended up making two batches of kombucha. The first was a journey of doubt, but also triumph, and I learned a lot. But during that period of doubt and frustration, in addition to frantically emailing Molly and Googling, I made a backup batch, which is why we have a second batch, which is actually doing quite well.
For this one, I did the same procedure, but used black tea and changed the ratio of SCOBY to sweet tea, so used a little bit less tea.
So at this point, our kombucha is technically done and we could drink it if we wanted to. But it doesn't have that fizziness or carbonation. Carbonation is often seen as the second stage of the kombucha brewing process. And as I was doing more research and experimenting with it myself, I realized that there's actually a good amount of complexity and detail here. So we're going to do a whole separate episode on carbonation and how that works. Okay, so I know that's probably not that satisfying because this doesn't feel like our traditional final product of kombucha that we'd see in the grocery store. So while we'll dive into more detail in a separate episode about carbonation, flavoring after the fermentation process, as well as what to do with your SCOBY now that it's been a week, we do have some example carbonated kombuchas that we've been working with, and we'll briefly look at them right now. So this is our final product. It's half grapefruit juice and half of the kombucha we brewed. We did this yesterday and then bottled it. There are lots of bubbles in here, and I'm excited to see what it tastes like. This, I think I could sell this. Like, this is just as good as the store-bought kombuchas I've had. So much cheaper. Now that I understand how to make it, I would totally make it again. The only point of criticism I have is that I now want to put it in the fridge or add some ice to it. It's just, it's not as refreshing as it could be because it's at room temperature. But literally, I'm going to go drink all of this right now. I'm just going to add a couple ice cubes and... Yeah, I love this. All right, final thoughts. Honestly, this is one of my favorite episodes to film because I learned so much. I feel like I'm just getting started. Like, I just got my bearings before. I didn't even really know what a SCOBY was. I had heard of it, but had no idea what it actually is. Now I feel like I have the foundation to truly experiment and play. So stay tuned for more future episodes and be sure to like and subscribe.